Vosgois.
Henri Vosgois founded Action Française in 1899. It was both a movement and a newspaper which propagated that movement. It was anti-Dreyfusard, anti-Semitic, anti-corporatist, anti-Republican, anti-democratic, anti-Protestant, anti-Masonic. It goes without saying that it was xenophobic. Maurice Barrès was soon involved, and so too was the demagogue, Charles Maurras.
It was Catholic and monarchist. It supported Mussolini and Franco. However, its enthusiasm for Hitler was tempered, not because it disapproved of his doctrine, but because it still hadn't got over the defeat by Germany at Sedan more than 60 years before. And its subsequent pro-Vichy stance derived from the odd conviction that by collaborating, France would retain its identity.
Identity is a perennial concern of the far right. Its enemies are rootlessness and cosmopolitanism. Identity in this sense is a form of communitarianism, which defines people by their race and inherited culture rather than by their individuality, their aspirations, and their talents. It's a kind of prison.
In the years after the war, the Second World War, one of Action Française's street hawkers was the young Jean-Marie Le Pen. Later, he would serve in the army in Indochina and Algeria and enter parliament as its youngest member in 1956 under the banner of Poujadism, which took its name from the stationer and rabble-rouser Pierre Poujade, the deafening voice of the silent majority. There is then a direct link from the nationalism and revanchism fomented by the defeat in 1870 to the chippy, paranoiac nationalism of the present day. There's a direct line from Barrès and Maurras to Jean-Marie and thence to his daughter and successor, Marine Le Pen.
This fringe is always with us. It is also always impotent. Its erectile dysfunction is due to its being a perpetual dupe. More opportunistic populists portray it as a bogey, a no-hoper, whilst at the same time filching its ideas and sanitising them. Every other strain of French politics changes by the month, even by the week. The absurd right's inflexibility is a national, not to say nationalistic, marvel. It stays put, it stays pure, it stays white, mostly. It stays wounded. Like Philoctetes, its sores will never heal.
Vedette.
Sûr de vous et sûr d'elle. Beaulieu, Chambord, tradition grand tourisme. Éprouvez-les chez votre concessionnaire Simca Vedette.
The mortally wounded OAS's endgame was played out against the glossy backdrop of Les Trente Glorieuses, which were not yet so called. Les Trente Glorieuses. Today, it's an everyday phrase. It derives from the title of a book of the late 70s by the economist Jean Forestier. It signifies the roughly 30 years from the liberation of France until the first oil crisis in 1973, a period of exponential industrial growth and the rush towards modernization, both public and private. The standard of living rose threefold during this period. Forestier was no doubt an ironist. The word glorious was a provocation. In his estimation, glory derives from the spread of affluence, the triumph of consumerism, medical advances, improved education, improved working conditions, improved public services, and so on. I own, therefore I am. I am happier, I am healthier. Now that I drive a Simca Vedette and possess plenty of plenty, the state is no longer solely an ideal to which I bear quasi-religious fealty and adolescent resentment. It is also a supplier with which I enjoy a near-commercial relationship in exchange for my taxes, my heavy taxes. For Forestier, then, glory had little to do with the nation-state's mystical allegiance to soil, with self-regarding pomp, with vaunting exhortations to patriotism. Which is just as well, for these were otherwise startlingly inglorious years for France, marked by political ignominy, political chaos, political assassinations, attempted putsches, a bloodless coup d'état, presidential mendacity, social catastrophe, near revolution,
and war upon grinding war, Europe, Indochina, Algeria.
For a martially preening nation, France's war record in the 20th century was dismal. Played for, lost for. Throwing the sponge becomes habit forming.
Ik heb een mansarde gemeubeld gehuurd, vlak neffens een klein stamineke. Bij het Antwerpse steen, een gezellige buurt, daar wil ik u even van spreken. Ik zie zo geren mijn duivenkot, daar te zijn is mijn grootst genot. Kom deel nu met mij daar je leven en lot, hoog op mijn duivenkot.
Verdun.
Pour celui qui en revient, Verdun, c'était bien. Pour celui qui en est mort, Verdun, c'est un port. Mais pour ceux qui n'étaient pas nés, qui n'étaient pas là pour apprécier, c'est du passé, dépassé. Un champ perdu dans le nord-est, entre Épinal et Bucarest. C'est une statue sur la grande place, finalement Verdun. Ce n'est qu'un vieux qui passe.
Verdun. The 10-month battle in 1916 claimed 300,000 lives. The name is France's greatest trigger to remembrance. It is to France what the Somme is to Britain. One difference, of course, is that Verdun is on home soil. A second is that beside Lutyens' monument to the Somme's victims at Thiepval, the Douaumont-Ossuary seems architecturally inappropriate.
It's not exactly frivolous, but it lacks solemnity, it lacks gravity. It recalls the architecture of pleasure, monstrously distended. It's inimical to meditative remembrance. Its architects lacked the nerve to address the awful purpose of the monument. They shamefully made light of it. They created a 140-meter-long betrayal of the dead. One might also add that they were victims of the modernist century's incapacity to devise a commemorative mode. No century ever needed one more.
Bien sûr que je n'étais pas né, je n'étais pas là pour apprécier, mais j'avais un vieux à Verdun, et comme je n'oublie jamais rien, je reviens je reviens. Je reviens.
Verlaine.
This is Paul Verlaine's Ode to Meades. Fate made Meades my cradle. It was raped. Yet it remains demure, more virginal than ever. Childhood was bliss in this place, whose fortress was no fortress, for its commandant's weapon was the white flag. This was the proud mother I loved.
The commandant in question was François Achille Bazaine. In 1870, he threw the sponge after Meades had been besieged for 2 months. The animals had been eaten, and typhus had become rampant. Hardly a cheese-eating surrender monkey, as the Bosch, Donald Rumsfeld, would have had it. When France is as porous border admits the invading armies of its bad neighbour, it admits 2 German buildings. The station at Meades is wholly German. The round arch neo-Romanesque idiom forms no part of France's architectural lexicon. Barès described it as an immense squat meat pie, a characterisation that is more xenophobic than aesthetic.
The station and the burghers' palaces nearby were built after the annexation of Northern Lorraine in 1870, at the end of the Franco-Prussian War. They're didactic buildings, intended as instruments of subjugation. They're architectural manifestations of Imperial Prussia's might.
The restorations of existing buildings were designed to rewrite history and render them Teutonic. Versailles.
'62. The night I arrived at Dunkirk, Roger de Gueld, the OAS fighter, was arrested in distant Algiers. He was tried by a kangaroo court. Edgar Lamina, the general who was to have presided over that court, killed himself rather than sit in pre-judgment. On July the 5th, 1962, Algeria became independent. The next day, Roger de Gueld was clumsily executed by a firing squad, most of whose members tried to miss the target. This judicial murder eventually took 30 minutes. The sentence was devised to appease bien-pensant piety, to sate liberal bloodlust. After his death, he was the object of black propaganda. He'd been a Belgian, a collaborator, a member of the Waffen-SS Wallonian Rexis Brigade. He had, in fact, been a résistant, as had many other members of the OAS. This, of course, did not and does not accord with the calumnization of the OAS as fascist. On the contrary, as Winston Churchill had observed 20 years before, the quasi-fascist was Charles de Gaulle, who had conducted his resistance from Carlton Gardens in St. James's.
De Gueld's grave in the Gonard Cemetery at Versailles is the site of an annual ceremony attended by his fellow outcasts who survived, men and women turned into pariahs by de Gaulle's treachery. It routinely prompts protests. Algeria is always with us.